So, question number four is, what is a user story and how to write a user story? So, user story is an informal general explanation of a software feature. Okay, so for example, the tool that we are going to use to write a user story is called Jira software. So it's a very common tool that is being used in the industry. So when we have an access to Jira software, so when you get a job, they will give you the access right for this software. Once you get that, and once you start gathering requirements from the business owners, now you have to create a user story. Okay, so we go here, click on create, and then in the issue types, it comes as it's story. So story is nothing but user story. And usually the format of this is as a, like I've told in this slide, okay, so as a I so that. So as the end user, I want to log in so that I can see my account page. As a new user, I want to get access to my bank account page. Or as an existing user, I want to update my personal information in the bank account page. So like this, you'll always like write user stories as if you are the end user. So user story is nothing but it is written from the perspective of a end user or a customer. So instructions will be like, as a I want to so that. Okay, so let me give you an example. So if you want to say that you're creating a, okay, so you're creating a login page. Okay, so you can say that you are a new customer. Now you want to get access to your account. Now what you'd say, as a new customer, I want to get access to the member portal so that I can update my personal information. Okay, so always a user story starts from the customer's view, and you will be always saying what the customer want to do and why they want to do. Okay, that is the user story. So once you create that, then you put like all the description, like detailedly, like for example, what is the member portal link, how their first page should be, what is in login page, right? If they don't have an account, how to create an account, how to register and create an account, all this detail you will add in the description. But in the summary, in the headlines, it will be always be like one liner like this, as a new customer, I want to so that. So this is a standard, like the way of writing a user story. And in some companies like Microsoft and all that, they'll give you examples and they will ask you to write a user story. So you always be prepared. Don't always like answer in a very generic format. Answer in a format that how they want to, like they want to see it. Right? For example, they give you an example. Then you have to like write on, they may give you a case study, and then they may be like, can you write a user story for this? So for that, you need to know this is the format. As a, I want so that. Okay, you can take any examples from your resume, like the existing examples that whatever you have, or if you don't have experience, I have given a couple of case studies in my YouTube channel. You can go and watch that. From that, you can grab the user stories and you can tell that too. So that's how we write. So this is a format, as a I want so that. Okay, and in the description you can put it detailedly, but this is how you create a user story. Once it is created, it will go to the backlog. Okay, it will be in the backlog. If you see in the backlog, you'll be able to see it in the backlog. Okay. Okay, now the next question is, how are user stories, epics, and task different? So from the previous slide, like I've told, like once you have access to Jira software, you'll be having like many types of issues. Okay, so you will be having stories, you will have tasks, you will have epics, and you'll have bugs. There are four different types of like issue types. We say it as in Jira, like in Agile, we say it as issue types. So what is the difference between all these four? That's the question. That's the interview question. So user stories are nothing but They are simple explanations of the business requirements, but we are writing from the end user perspective. Okay, we are always writing like in very simple terms, in one lines, we are writing the summary for the user stories. The business requirements is always very straightforward and simple. Anybody who's reading the user story is able to understand it. That simple it is. What is epic? Epic is nothing but usually like a high level of all the user stories. Under epic, you can have so many user stories. So I'm going to give you an example. So if you want to create an epic, like, okay, for example, automation of like I have already given automation of check. So this is a project. Okay, so we are going to what is this project? Manually nowadays we are going to the bank and we are going to give the check and process it, right? But you can do it from home itself. So if you have a check, you can just scan through the mobile application and then you are able to process that check. So if that is the project, the very very high level requirement, right, we are writing it as epic. Under one epic we will have multiple user stories. Okay, so epic is nothing but it's a very very high level requirement and it is actually usually very large and complex. Under one epic you can have multiple user stories. So the user stories can be like how to make sure that a check is getting scanned through mobile application, through like barcode, or how it is able to pull extract all the members' information, like for example first name, last name, account number, and how it is able to identify actual amount, and how it is able to identify whether it is the correct check, it is not a duplicate of an existing check. So all these validations that a mobile application has to do, right? So everything will have a separate user story. So all that can be user stories, but epic is nothing but a higher level requirement. Okay, overall, like overall in the project, right, you have a very big requirement that is called a epic. And what are tasks? Tasks are nothing but it is used to break down user stories. So it is the smallest unit in the Scrum framework, and it takes about like only one or two people, or within like 3 to 4 hours maximum to finish a task. Okay, so when we create task, like you can always create it like creating a BRD. Okay, creating a BRD, or maybe creating a mapping document, or it can be creating a UAT test plan. So all these small tasks, okay, so this will not require like for example 8 hours or more than that of work, right? So this is like, for example, you need to create a UAT test plan, this can be done within 4 hours. So all these like small kind of work that can be done can be identified as task. So then what is the difference between now task and story? Story is like more than 8 hours, I would say. If you have something to work more than 8 hours, then that is a story. And if it is like less than 8 hours and you can finish it within like 4 hours, 3 hours, or 5 hours, then I would identify it as task. And also bug is nothing but it is defects. Okay, so something you are doing testing, you're identifying some kind of defects, that will be identified as bug. Epic is nothing but higher level requirements. So these are the four different types of issues in agile methodology. So they may ask you to give you examples. So you have to take one case study and then you have to give them like separate, and instead of telling it very theoretically, you can always take like one example and then you can say this is an epic and this is a user story and this is a task and this is how we identify. The next question is, what is a sprint and how long is each sprint? Sprint is nothing but the amount of time required for a developer and tester and also a business analyst to complete your work. So for example, basically in sprint, right, there are like many types. So you can have a 2 week sprint, 3 week sprint, 4 week sprint. So in 2 weeks, for example, if you have a 2 week sprint, you're going to have 10 working days. Of course, if there are no holidays. In 3 week sprint, you're going to have 15 working days. And in 4 week sprint, you're going to have 20 working days in case you don't have any holidays, right? So mostly sprints are always like 2 weeks, in the sense it is 10 working days, 3 weeks in the sense it's 15 working days, and 4 weeks is nothing but it's 20 working days. So within this time, if any user story that you are picking up in that particular sprint, for example, your project is having only a 2 week sprint, means in the 10 days, whatever user stories that you are picking or your developers or testers they are picking, they have to complete within that 10 days. Okay, so your timeline to finish a user story is only 10 days. And if your team is having 3 week sprints, they have to complete all their user stories and tasks and all their work within like 15 working days. And if it is a 4 week sprint, you're going to have 20 working days. So when you create user stories, for example, where you're creating all sorts of, like in the backlog, you can say that I have an epic, I have a bug, I have a task. You create all these user stories, but you will never know like how long it will take for a user story will get completed. That's why we have something called story points. So when I open here, there is something called story points here to finish this, like how long it is going to take, what are the total number of points it is going to take. So depending upon the points, you can always like identify whether it's a one pointer user story, two pointers, three pointers. So for example, here it has three pointer user story, and this one can be like a two pointer. You have to discuss that with your developer, and you have to identify what are the story points. So one pointer means it's going to take less time. Two pointer means it is going to take a little bit more. Three pointer means a little more. Five pointer is like it is a complex. Eight pointer is like too much complex. That story is going to take a lot of time. So what is a sprint? Whatever user story that you are taking, for example, you can take two pointer stories, you are able to complete that, or you can take one 8 pointer story if you are able to complete that. So just by seeing the user story, right, for example, this user story, this one can be as complex like an 8 pointer. Okay, so if it is an 8 pointer user story, I can take only this one story in my particular sprint and finish it. So don't rely on like the number of user stories. Not like you take 10 user stories means you are like you can it can be done in 2 weeks. No, it is about the effort for every user story. For some user stories, it can take only 1 points. For some user story, it can take 2 points. For some user stories, it can take 3 points. So you have to discuss with your development team, and then make sure like every story, like what is a story point for every user story. Accordingly, you need to choose your user stories within that particular days and finish it. So that will be done in sprint planning session. So that will during sprint planning, right, yourself, your developers, and also testers, and your product owner, your scrum master, everybody will sit together. They will review the backlog, and depending upon like the story points, we can take the user story. So they are not assigning you. You are going to pick up the user stories whichever has the highest priority, and you are going to make sure that is done in the next sprint. So this is about sprint and how long is each sprint. The next question is, what is the difference between sprint backlog and product backlog? So as I've told you here, sprint backlog means, like for example, whatever you create here, it will be always in the backlog. So this is called as product backlog. So this is like, for example, you create 10 user stories, and your colleague is creating 10, another developer is creating 10, and a tester is they are creating their own user stories. So they're going to have, as a product backlog, as a whole team, you're going to have 200 or 300 user stories, right? But depending upon your sprint timeline, for example, you have a 4 week sprint, okay, you have 20 day working days for the next sprint. So in that case, you can choose only limited, because you have limited capacity with your team. Someone is going on vacation, or someone is sick, they are not able to come for next 10 days. So you have limited capacity. You have only two business analysts, two developers, and two testers. So within that capacity, like how many user stories you can pick, and you'll be able to finish in that particular sprint. So the number of user stories that you will be like finishing in that particular sprint is called as sprint backlog. Product backlog is nothing but as a whole, like how many user stories you are having in the like complete in your team, like totally how many user stories are there in the backlog, that is product backlog. So there is a difference between sprint backlog and a product backlog. Okay, so you can always say that, like for example, here you can see this is sprint. Okay, that sprint is there, and we can always This is the existing backlog. Like all the user stories are there. And if you want to push the user stories from here to your current sprint, you can always drag and drop. Okay. So if you're able to drag and drop here, and you can always move this to your current sprint. So you can make it as in progress. Okay. So that's the difference between sprint backlog and product backlog. So sprint backlog is nothing but in your current sprint, how much you are user stories you are having. Product backlog is like overall in the team, like how many user stories you are having. So when they ask you in the interview, do you know about product backlog? Yes, of course, we know. Product backlog is nothing but it's a list of user stories or epic or tasks which is created by our entire team. Whereas sprint backlog is nothing but the user stories that we choose to complete within that particular amount of time. That is sprint backlog. And the next question is, what are daily stand-ups? Can you explain what happens in a daily stand-up meeting? So daily stand-up meeting is nothing but a discussion that happens every day. So every day morning or in the afternoon sometime, regularly we are going to have a daily status meeting. You can always say stand-up meetings or status meetings. So in these meetings, everyone from your team has to join. So developers, testers, business analysts, scrum master, product owner, everybody will join. Manager may or may not join. Sometimes the manager joins, but usually they don't join. So what we do in this stand-up meeting or status meeting is nothing but we are going to track everybody's work. So once we assign user stories to our team, every day we are going to track the status of this team. So whether it was done or whether it's still in progress or you are yet to start. And if you have not started, why you didn't start? And if it's in progress, you have some blocker or you're dependent on some other team or you're dependent on some other developer or tester, then you can always say that I'm dependent on this tester. I'm just waiting for the feedback. So everyday status call is nothing but to actually like track the status of your user stories. So if you have any blockers, you can say there, or if you want to coordinate with your team members, you can say there, or if you have any dependency on other teams, you can always put it there and also discuss with your team members. Of course, you can always like ping them. You can always email them and you can always connect with them privately also. But this is like you're telling the entire team what is happening with your user stories so that everybody's aware of the status of your user stories. And as a team, as a Scrum team, like how you're able to achieve the completion of your user stories within that particular span of time. So that is the reason for daily stand-up meetings. And the next question is, what is sprint planning? So this is very, very, very important. Sprint planning, like I've already told you, once you've created and your team have created all the user stories and you're ready for the next sprint. For example, the next sprint is next Monday, the upcoming Monday. Now, this Friday, you're going to have a sprint planning call where all your user stories, like from the entire team, right? We are going to go through all the user stories and we are going to pick up only certain user stories for the upcoming sprint. Since because you created like 200 or 300 user stories, doesn't mean everything has to be picked in the upcoming sprint, okay? So sprint is like very short timeline. It can be 2 weeks, 3 weeks or 4 weeks. Depending upon your team, it will change. And depending upon the company also, it is going to change, okay? So suppose you have a four-week sprint, your team is following a four-week sprint, and you're having an upcoming sprint on like from the next Monday. Friday, you are going to have this sprint planning call. The product owner is going to go through every user story, and they're going to ask you what are the story points, and which are the priorities, and which business owner has that highest priority, and how many capacity we have, like as a team, like who is going on PTO, how many holidays we have. And we are going to calculate all that when you're going to pick up the user stories. That is called as sprint planning call. So basically, we are deciding upon like how much work can be done during the next sprint and how much, what is the total capacity for our team? Okay, how many people are on holidays or how many people are like, do we have any like holidays for us? Like you'll have some national holidays, right? So whether we are, as a team, we are having any holidays or someone is going on PTO or someone is sick. So we have to plan accordingly depending upon our capacity and we are going to choose our user stories for our next sprint. And the next question is, what is sprint retrospective? Sprint retrospective is nothing but it's a review meeting that is like done at the end of each sprint. So like from the next Monday you're having a new sprint, this Friday you will have both sprint planning and sprint retrospective meeting too. So sprint retrospective meeting is nothing but we are having a review with our entire team on discussing about like what are the problems we faced in the current sprint and how can we improve our next sprint and what went wrong in our current sprint and what are the measures that we can make sure that doesn't happen in the next sprint, right? So as a team, you can always say that how you were, if you achieved all your user stories and you are not postponing your user stories to the next sprint, that means you had a good sprint, right? You're not supposed to postpone your user stories. If you pick some user stories for that particular sprint, you're able to finish that user stories. Suppose in case like if you don't know, if you had dependency on other team and you didn't finish your work and your user stories are postponed to the next sprint, then you can always tell your scrum master and product owner in this meeting that in current sprint for this particular story we had a dependency on another team and we were not able to get the status from them and we had a dependency and we were not able to finish our current user story, so we had to postpone this particular user story. So this is more like lessons learned session, and everybody is going to give what are the good and the bad that we have done in the current sprint, and we're going to learn it, we're going to document it and make sure that doesn't happen in our next sprint. So this will be conducted by the scrum master or the product owner. You'll be just as a business analyst, you'll be just attending and giving your feedback, but sprint planning meetings and sprint retrospective meetings are conducted by the scrum master. So the next question is, what is MVP? MVP is nothing but minimum viable product. So what is minimum viable product? You are creating a user story and you are creating some kind of product, right? So this is software development. What we are talking about in agile business is software development. So at end of each sprint, like you are creating some kind of product so that the end user or the business owner is able to test it, right? So always keep in mind that when they say minimum viable product, some product that they are able to, like the users are able to see the product and they're able to understand the product and they're able to test the product. That's what is called as minimum viable product. So for example, even if you're creating like a login page and you're making sure like the end user is able to log in. Okay. And even in that, if it's not going to be a complete requirement, at least some part of the requirement is able to, like the business owner is able to test it. So I'm just taking like a very small example of registration or login. So even though the complete functionality of that particular requirement is not completed, at the end of each sprint, you're able to show them, the business owner, something that they're able to see visually and they're able to test it, right? So for some projects, you can complete the whole project in like one or two sprints. For some project, it is going to take three sprints or more than that. So it depends upon the complexity of your project. The timeline also changes. So for very small projects, small enhancement projects, you can complete in one or two sprints. But if there is going to be a very massive project and you are establishing that in like multiple markets, then the project can go, even though it's an agile project, it can go like from three sprint to more than that. So like till the end of that 4 months, nobody is going to wait. So the business owner wants to see something at end of every sprint. So they may be like, can you show me something? And I want to see and test something. So that is called as minimum viable product. So in Agile, at end of every sprint, we are making sure that user story is like very end user friendly. And the business owner or the end user is able to test some part of that user story. So that is called as minimum viable product. So the next question is about can you explain story points calculation? So story points are always calculated in Fibonacci series, like 1-pointer stories, 2-pointer stories, 3-pointer stories, 5-pointer stories, 8-pointer and 13-pointers. So for this story points, always like you have to remember, user stories can be like any of these pointers, right? It can be one pointer, two pointers. So every story, right, depending upon how much effort it's going to take, you're going to give points here. Now, if you don't know how to give points, because sometimes you don't know, like this task may or the story may look very simple and you may give 1 point. In reality, that may take long hours and you will end up like, oh my God, I didn't calculate it properly. So that comes through experience, like how many points you have to give for every user story. But basically, you need to understand that story points estimation is going to be a bigger task for you as a Scrum team, like the entire team. You don't want to lose track of your estimation, because like imagine you think, like for example, you have about 4 user stories, everything is an 8-pointer user story, and you're picking all these 8-pointer user stories, very complex user stories for your next sprint. And while doing every story, then you realize that you cannot complete that because everything is time consuming and you're able to finish only 1 or 2 user stories in an sprint. You're not able to finish the other 2. And in the sprint call, you're saying that I cannot complete because I'm like already stuck with these 2 user stories. There is no time for me to finish it. So that is going to backfire you. So you have to be very smart in estimating the user stories before the sprint planning session, and making sure you give the right points and how much work you can done, because Agile is very like short period, right? Every sprint is going to be very quick. It's going to be 10 days, 15 days and 20 days. So you're going to pick your user stories very smartly, and also like what is the priority for every user story, and you're going to give points. So initially you may struggle giving points, but this is very, very important for you to not take too much work and like and then get embarrassed in status calls. So for that, you need to understand it is always given in Fibonacci series. So it's not like there is no like a 4-point user story or 6-point user story or 7-point user story. Okay. So story points are given in Fibonacci series, and you're going to estimate the user stories by like amount of time it's going to take. Okay. So here they say that usually story points versus hours. So we don't give hours. So it's nothing. It's not that 1-pointer means 1 hour, 2-pointer means 2 hours. It's not like that. We are going to make sure that you estimate depending upon like how many emails that you're going to get, how many meetings you're going to attend, and how many interviews you're going to have with the business owners, and how long it's going to take time for you to get coordinate with other teams. And like it is like based upon solving problems, based upon difficulty or not time spent. So for example, don't think about, also you have to estimate time, that is also there. So I would say like you have to combine both time and like also dealing with people, right? Like you need to make sure that, oh, okay, to coordinate with this particular team is going to be tough for me because they don't respond very easily, and I have to like send multiple follow-ups. And to coordinate with this particular business owner is going to be like time consuming because they don't come to the meetings very usual. They're always booked and their time slot is always booked. So you're going to like follow up with them multiple times. So it is like both how complex is the work, technical work, and also like how difficult it is for you to coordinate with various different teams. So don't directly like even though sometimes the stories to finish your technical work, it can take like 1 or 2 hours, but that coordination is going to take longer time for you. Okay, so you have to keep all that in mind, and you have to give your story points, and it will take time. It's not that the very first call you're able to like judge every user story properly, right? So as as you get experienced, you are able to give the correct story points. But you have to keep in mind that always I would say give a point extra, because you never know like how much time it's going to take for your user story to get completed. So that is called as story points calculation. So the next question is, what is a burnt up chart? So I'm going to give you an example. So if you go to Jira software and if you're going to log in into reports, okay, you'll be able to, like for example, here in projects, right? Under projects, you'll have reports, and if you're able to click the reports, you'll have both burn down chart and burn up chart. So what is burn up chart? So burn up chart is nothing but it is a visual representation of a sprint's completed work compared with its total scope. So we are going to like see, or we are going to track our teams progress and how many user stories were completed, and do we have any problems in this particular sprint. So we're going to track that and we are going to give it as a report. Okay, so mostly you will have the story points here and you're going to have the timeline here. Okay, so always it's going to be like monthly wise, or depending upon if you can also customize it like based upon your sprints to sprints one, sprint two, like that. So mostly you are going to have time versus story points and how much it was done, how much work was done. Okay, what is the scope for our for that particular sprint and how much work it was done. So how are we going to track it? We are going to track by means of like this is automatic, right? So like this software itself is giving you the capacity to track all the user stories depending upon like whether it is an in progress or whether it's completed and what is the story points, how much it is completed, like that. It is going to automatically like track based upon the event. Okay, when was the sprint started, when was the user story added. So you need not do anything like manually. All you have to do is you have to go here and you have to figure out like whether it is progressing or it's going down. Okay, so the next question is, what is a burn down chart? So this also we can explain in the report section. So if you go to reports, you're going to have burn down chart. Okay, so in the burn down chart, we are here, we are going to track like story points versus like every day, like how much work was done. Okay, so for example, sprint was started in this particular date and then there was scope change there and we added new stories in the middle of the story. So we removed the stories because it doesn't have any priority right now. The business don't want to like progress it. So for some reasons we are adding new stories, or we are making sure that existing stories need not be progressed, and we are going to make sure here these are the story points and this is timelines, and here we can have like every day, like what is the progress of that user story and how that user story was completed or not. If all the user stories are completed for that particular timeline for sprint, it means that your burn down chart will be very straight like this. Okay, and it's a good burn down chart. So we can always use these charts to make sure that how much existing work was done and how much changes was done in every sprint, so that like for the next sprint, right, we make sure that doesn't like happen. Because the requirements, as a business analyst, the requirements are changing constantly. Even though you have picked up your user stories and you're like developing and you're testing, suddenly the business owner is saying that no, we need not progress that, stop that, or maybe add a new feature. So it's not like planned very well. In Agile, there'll be constant changes, okay? It's not like waterfall methodology. Here, the requirements can be constantly changing. And also, within that particular timeline, you have to finish the work, okay? They are going to change the requirements, but they will ask you to finish the requirements because it is an Agile methodology. So your mind will be like, what is this? I've just started the work, or I'm in the middle of something and I'm testing something. Now they want to change something. So you should not be frustrated, because keep in mind that this is an Agile methodology project and there will be constant changes and you have to adapt to that changes. And so for you, this is something it needs to be like normal. Okay, so even though you're in the middle of testing something, or you are like almost you got the sign off, now suddenly they're asking you to like make sure that you're getting new stories. So you may have stories that may be pulled in between the sprint, or some stories which is like postponed, or we don't want to carry forward or progress with it. So based upon this burnt up and burn down chart, you are able to identify like how this particular sprint went, and we are going to document that so that that doesn't happen in our next sprint. So that is burn down chart. And the next one is, what is sprint velocity? So I already told you, like velocity chart is nothing but like how many people are there in our team, in our development team, and on our scrum team, how many people are there. So let me give you an example. Like for example, we have about like only like two developers. Okay, let's say that we are a very small team. We have only two developers, two business analysts, and we have two testers, and we have one scrum master and one product owner. Okay, so in this scenario, it's a very small scrum team, and everybody is going to, like for example, your team has only like 2 week sprint. Okay, 2 week sprint means it's like 10 working days. So in the 10 working days, we need to calculate how many user stories can two developers take, and how many user stories can two business analysts take, and how many user stories can two testers take. Okay, so we cannot, like, that is called a sprint velocity. Like how much like our team can take, because we cannot make sure like all the 200, 300 user stories can be completed in the upcoming sprint, right? So our product owner and scrum master, they will be doing this sprint velocity or sprint capacity, right? So we are making sure that according to our team's capacity, we are determining how many user stories can be taken. Okay, so for example, if it's 10 working days, you can have maximum, you can take only 10 story points. Okay, so it can be like two story points, and you can be an 8-pointer, you can take two stories, or it can be 5-pointer and a 3-pointer, or 5-pointer and a 5-pointer. So we are making sure that beyond this, we are not like overloading ourselves with too much work, because as I told you, the most important thing is we have to make sure our work is completed within that particular sprint. So sprint velocity is nothing but we are calculating how many people are there in our team and how many working days are there in that particular sprint, and depending upon that, we are determining how many story points like everybody needs to pick. And depending upon the story points, now you can pick the user stories. Okay, so for example, the capacity is like only like 10 point user stories. Everybody can pick only 10 point user stories. You can pick like 10 1-pointer stories, or 2 5-pointer stories, or maybe 2 2-pointer and 8-pointer. So depending upon the story capacity, the complexity, you're going to choose the user stories. Okay, so this is called a sprint velocity. So next question is, how do you coordinate with other teams? So this is a very, very important question, because in Agile, you may be like tired of coordinating with multiple teams and dependency with external vendors, and inside your organization itself, like you can have divisions, like IT teams can be like maybe multiple IT teams, and you have to do cross-team coordination. So for that, we use a terminology called scrum of scrum meeting is recommended. So this is usually by means of a scrum master. So you can always say in everyday stand-up call that I followed up with this particular team. They are not giving any response. They are not giving any feedback. So what I have to do? So you have to raise all your risk in your daily stand-up call. And then your scrum master will be someone who will take responsibility of coordinating with the other scrum teams. So if it's going to be a very massive project, and you have done your best, but still you don't get any kind of response from the other teams, and they are not giving any kind of feedback through emails, or you don't know what is the status of that in their project. Now you always have to escalate to your scrum master, and the scrum master will be conducting the scrum of scrum meetings, and they will make sure that they coordinate with the other scrum teams, and they will take responsibility. From as a business analyst, your responsibility is like you can try one time or two times, and then you have to escalate it to your scrum master to make sure that they will coordinate from their side. And we have to make sure that, because you don't want to complicate yourself and become tired of like coordinating with other teams, right? So you follow up with them like one or two times, and then you escalate it to your scrum master, and they will be having the scrum of scrum meetings. So very, very important for achieving cross-team coordination. So the next is, what is scrum of scrum? So it's nothing but it's a scaled agile technique that offers a way to connect multiple teams who need to work together to deliver complex solutions. So suppose you are having like four different teams, okay, four different technical IT teams, and then you have two external vendors, or not even your company, you have some offshore teams, okay, two offshore teams. So like you cannot be coordinating with everybody, right? So this is a massive project. You are working, you are representing only one IT team and you need to coordinate with multiple teams. Now what we have to do is we have to perform this scrum of scrum meeting, and we are going to make sure that every team is able to tell their status of work, what is the progress of work, and when can they finish their testing, when can they finish their development, when can we do the complete UAT testing. All these meetings, right, is called as scrum of scrum. This is usually done by a scrum master, but you need to know, because as a business analyst you need to know this is nothing but a scaled agile technique that is used to connect multiple. So the next question is, what are the three pillars of scrum? So three pillars of scrum is nothing but transparency, inspection and adaptation. So we are going to learn that. So they're going to ask you if you're following or if your team is following scrum methodology, what are the three pillars of scrum? So first is transparency. What is transparency? You're going to make sure that every user story, whatever is in the backlog, or entire team is able to see it. Okay, so in this Jira board, whatever stories you create or your colleagues create, everything, everybody is able to see it. Inside your team, they will have permission to see it. So they can view your sprint backlog, they can view the product backlog, and they are going to see what is the status of your user stories, whether it was done or whether it is in progress. So everybody inside your development team or the scrum team is able to view all the user stories and the work that you're doing and the progress that you're making for your user stories. That's why we are using Jira software. That's why we are tracking every even single like task or even like small even work that you have done. We are tracking it to make sure we are giving credit for your work. So that is called as transparency, by following all this backlog, also having sprint reviews. So every once in a while we are going to have sprint reviews asking like feedback with these stakeholders. Sprint review is like you are going to make sure all the stakeholders are there and you're going to ask feedback from them. That is sprint review. And definition of done. When you're completing a task or user story, what is the meaning of done? So you have to make sure that that particular user story acceptance criteria is actually achieved, so that you can say that that particular user story is completed or that particular task is completed. So acceptance criteria is very, very, very important. Also, the next one is, if you are very transparent in Scrum, what will happen? So you can detect all the bugs in the very early stage. Okay, so defects detection is nothing but it's very important. You make sure that you are able to catch all the bugs or you're able to identify all the defects in a very early stage, so that you don't have problems with the business owners going forward. So early detection of all the bugs and issues, that's very, very, very critical. Also, you're making sure you're taking accountability, right? So because you are doing a particular task and it is under your name, means like you are responsible for that task. So you're not like blaming on some developer or tester. Every task that you create or every user story that you create, it is going to be under your name. So you're taking like that clear accountability of that particular work that is being done under your name. And you can also understand, you can engage all your stakeholders. So that involves all your developers, testers, business owners, and you can also show them like how much work. They need not be directly pinging you all the time. So you can always like make sure you give the user story numbers and they're able to see the status of the user stories, and they're able to get the, like they will know like when you are able to complete that particular user stories. So stakeholders engagement is very important. Also identifying risk. So once you are doing the development or once you're testing, now you can identify a lot of risk and then you can catch it in the very earliest state before the completion of sprint itself. You are able to identify risk. So that's why Agile is like very popular now, because in short term, you're able to identify and you're able to like perform really well. And the next pillar is inspection. Inspection is nothing but how can we, it's not like micromanagement, it's like you are making sure everybody in the scrum team is like aware of what's happening in the team. Okay, so we have sprint planning calls, daily stand-up calls, we have sprint review calls and sprint retrospective calls. So I've told in the earlier questions about sprint planning, sprints, daily stand-ups, and sprint retrospective. Sprint review is nothing but we are involving stakeholders or the business owners, and we are doing a review with them. Sprint retrospective is internal to your team, whereas sprint review is like you are involving the external business owners and stakeholders, and you are reviewing the user stories with them. That's the difference between sprint review and sprint retrospective. The third one is adaptation. Adaptation is, like I've already told, you'll have multiple change requests and the requirements are constantly changing. Backlog is going to change, and some user stories will be added, some user stories will be postponed, some user stories needs to be abandoned. So you have to have that agile mindset to make sure that whatever new requirement you are getting, you're going to follow some protocols, make sure the business owners are being like addressed with those protocols. And also you have to discuss with your scrum master or project manager also, right? You cannot take decisions on your own. So we have to make sure you like coordinate with your scrum master, product owner, and the manager regarding the new request. And you have to do all the adjustments and adapt accordingly. So these are the three different pillars of scrum. Why we are doing this? Because of customer satisfaction. Whoever is giving the work to IT team, we are making sure that they are very happy with our process, because we are very flexible and we have good quality. We know how we follow a certain protocol and process, and we are making sure at the end of it, everybody is happy. They are happy, we are happy, and the customer end user is happy. That's the benefit of adaptation in Scrum. That's why Agile methodology is very, very popular now. So the next question is how to deal with scope creep. So scope creep is nothing but they are giving you requirements, but end of the day they are like adding more requirements, and initially whatever they thought, we thought that is a requirement, right? Now it is not a requirement anymore. So they're constantly changing that. So what we have to do is, to some extent, scope creep, like we can accept within our capacity, okay? But if you are, they're going to add very complex requirements, and they're going to like, it's going to be very tough for our development team to accommodate those requirements. Then in that case, it is going to be uncontrolled, and it is going to have a great impact on our time, our cost, our billing, and also during our sprint timeline, right? We are not able to complete that. So this is a very big problem in Agile, that constantly they are giving like more requirements, which you are not able to do it, right? So what we can do is, we have something called change control process. So for this, like when business owners are constantly like giving you requirements, you have to deal with that very professionally. You cannot be like very rude with them, and you cannot say that no, you cannot like add on requirements like this. So we are not supposed to answer like that. We are going to answer in a very professional way. So you can always say that we have a process called change control process, and all your new requirements needs to be submitted there, and we need approval for those change requests. Only then we can accommodate those new requirements. So for example, you gathered all the requirements, you created user stories, and you are working on the user stories in a particular sprint. Now in the middle of the sprint, now the business owner is coming and asking that, sorry, we have to change the requirements and we have to add new functionalities. Now how you need to answer them is, you have to say that, I understand your concerns. Now we have a process called change control process, that is within our IT teams, we follow this process. So what I will recommend you is, please create a user story for all the changes, and you need to submit it for that change request approval. So what they will do is, business owners, they will go here and they will have access to Jira as well, right? So they will go create the user stories. Okay, whatever is the enhancement or whatever is the new request, they're going to add it here, and that will be going for approval. So who needs to approve? Of course, your manager needs to approve. We don't have the like the responsibility of approving that, right? So it needs to go through different approvals from managers, and you have to discuss with your scrum master, your product owner, your manager, and you have to make sure that whether that change can be like whether it can be accommodated or not. Accordingly, after discussion with your developers, everybody, the whole crew, you're going to make sure whether that new user story is going to be added in that this sprint or the next sprint. Okay, so we follow something called change control process. So you should not be rude. That's the first thing. The business analyst should not be rude. They have to deal in a very professional manner. You tell them to submit the change request, and you say that I have to discuss with my manager and also my development team, and then we will get back to you on this change request. This is how you have to deal with scope creep. The next question is, what is the difference between Scrum and Kanban? So in Agile, right, we have different kind of Scrum methodologies. So we have something called Scrum, and then we have Kanban. So Scrum is mostly like, I have worked only in Scrum. I have never worked in Kanban based projects. So Scrum means you will have a sprint. It can be 2 weeks, 3 weeks, and 4 weeks. You'll have a Scrum Master. You'll have a product owner. And we will follow all the Scrum guidelines, right? Like everyday stand-up calls, sprint review calls, and sprint retrospective calls. And and then like all the sprint ceremonies, we do it. That is Scrum. Whereas Kanban means you don't have any timeline, okay? And you don't have a Scrum Master. You don't have a product owner. There is no defined roles. So there is mostly like for research projects, like for example, someone is working for like a brand, right? Like Nike, or you can say any kind of research based products, like their research department, right? They don't have a timeline. So they have user stories, but they don't have a timeline that they have to finish within like 2 to 4 weeks. So mostly like anybody in research, they can be product based, for example, Microsoft, also Facebook, they can be in the product based companies, but mostly in the research department. That's where like they have some amount of extra time, and they can do creatively, and they are able to come up with new ideas, and they're going to track all their work in Kanban. But in proper IT professionals, like for example, you're working in TCS, CTS, or you're working in some kind of like regular Fortune 4 companies, not in research department, you're in an IT professional, then mostly you will be following Scrum only. That's the difference between Scrum and Kanban. And the next question is, what are the tools used by Agile business analysts? Very, very important. You need to be an expert on Jira and Confluence. So as I've told here, this is a Jira software, and we also have Confluence in this. So you need to make sure that you are aware of all these products, and it is actually free only for 1 month. I think it is free. So you can use your email ID and then get this product for free. And you need to definitely, especially if you're a beginner, you need to like definitely understand there are so many like products inside Jira software. Okay. So you have reports, you have how to create user stories, you can create projects, you can create dashboards, and you can always like try exploring this software. And also Confluence. Confluence is for documentation, for creating BRDs, also creating all your diagrams, and also creating all your for documentation process, right? You have to be well aware of these two softwares. Of course, Microsoft Excel, Word, PowerPoint, all that will come, you have to learn that. But these two tools are very, very, very important. And just by seeing videos, you cannot learn it, right? So if you want to have really hands-on experience, you have to like download it. You have to make sure you play with it. And then you have like some understanding of all these softwares. It's very, very, very important. Okay. Jira and Confluence. And then what are the reports created by Agile business analyst? So there are different types of reports that we can create during this using this Jira. So for example, when you go to all reports, you can see you have burn down chart, burn up chart, you have sprint report, you have velocity chart, you have cumulative flow diagrams, and also you have version report, epic report, control chart, epic burn down, release burn down. So there are so many charts here. You have like pie chart report, average age report, like so many reports are there, time tracking report. So based upon your team, you can always create reports based upon your manager's requirements, because they're going to have a meeting with the staff VP, they're going to have a meeting with the leadership team. So they may ask you to suddenly give, like, can you please give me a report for last sprint? Can you give me a burn down report? Or like, how many stories our team completed? Can you please take a report? So you can go here and download this report and you can send it to your manager. So you need to be aware of all the reports, existing reports that you can get from the Jira software, so that you can give it to your manager for their meetings. So these are some of the reports. Okay, sprint report, burn down report, release burn down report. And there are like so many other reports also. So you can like download that software and you can learn all about those reports. So the next question is, how do you handle constant change in requirements? Like I've already told you, any scope creep or anything like constant change in requirements, we need to have a process called change control process. So in that change control process, we are asking them to submit user stories, okay, with whatever like now whatever they want to, like enhancement, right? So we have to make sure they are submitting the user stories, and we are making sure that you review those user stories, new user stories, with your development team. Okay, you have to review with your development team, you have to review with your scrum master, and you're going to review with your product owner, and also with your manager. With everybody you have to review, and after their approval only you are really promising your business owner that the new request is being granted and it's being approved by our entire team, and now we can work on the new change. If suppose they don't approve, they're saying that no, this requires extra billing or this will require extra time, we cannot finish this in our current sprint. So that also you have to like tell them, the business owners, that no, the new requirement whatever you have submitted, that requires extra billing or that requires extra time, we cannot complete that in the current sprint. And you have to explain to them, and back and forth you can communicate with your manager, and then you can give them feedback. So you have to always deal this very professionally. Do not be rude or angry. Very, very important. Always be in a very, in a professional way, you have to like deal with this, because you get frustrated because you have put so much time and effort in gathering requirements and they're constantly changing it. You may get frustrated, but understand this is an agile environment. This is how it is supposed to be. And you have to make, you have to like have a mindset that this is called agile mindset. Like this is how this works, and I have to make sure this is accommodated. And you're not alone. You have the whole crew with you, and you're going to take their opinions and approvals, and only then you're going to communicate with your business owners. The next question is, how do you handle conflicts or disagreements within an agile team? Now, this is something like everybody should learn. Okay, so you have to stick together. So suppose you have a conflict with your developer or your tester. You are all in one team. Okay, escalating is not a solution. You escalating a developer escalating you, and you escalating a tester, in my opinion, that's not a good way of being. Then it can become very toxic, and one fine day you're going to leave that team, right? So always, like, if you want to be a very comfortable team and you are going to make sure you're going to have a very happy team, then you have to stick together and you have to believe in each other and communicate with the developer or the tester. Okay, they are your team people, right? So you, even though you have different personalities and your opinions and experience and expertise and individual skills are going to be very different, you have to like respect each other, support each other, and help each other, and make sure that you're working as one team. Within your team, you can do that. But if you're having conflicts with some external team, then in that case also, you always make sure you are like communicating in a very professional manner, and they are also given some, they have this Jira software team, right? They have given some kind of tips like how to make sure once there is a conflict, what you have to do. You have to ask for a teammate's advice. You have to make sure the time is right. And when you decide to talk, you have to respect their boundaries. Don't risk embarrassment of your co-workers. Don't approach them when they are like they're very fussy, they're very busy, and like don't approach them that. And you have to start a conversation like Hey, I think we have some tension between us. Is it okay? Can we talk about it? And you also need to be positive. And if they are very, they don't understand, you have to give them some time for them. Ask sorry if needed. And don't put yourself in a very complex situation with them. This is a very professional environment, right? This is not your home. And you cannot scream at people, and you cannot use very like harsh words with people. Okay, this is a very professional environment, so you have to keep focused on the issue. Do not blame, and do not blame their personalities, and do not talk back. That's a wrong thing to do. Don't talk back with other colleagues about one person. Do not do that. Okay, you never know who's friends with who, and you never know who's related to whom. Okay, so I would say that you should always be professional. You should always talk to them. If you have any conflict on your persons, directly talk to them. And if you want to ask sorry, initiate that. Okay, so you can say, "I'm sorry, man. I'm like really sorry. I was tensed a little bit, and I was going through something. So I'm really sorry about it. Are you okay with it? And how can we be positive?" And the next time you're having a meeting with them, don't have that grudge in your mind. Okay, and that's how you have to move on. Because if you're having constant conflicts with your coworkers, that place can be really toxic, and you don't want to deal with that team anymore. So you have to make sure that you clear that air after the conflict, and be very positive. And one important thing is, don't talk back. Don't talk back about others with other colleagues. Okay, so that can be really an issue. So you have to always deal with them very professionally. This is how you deal conflicts with your internal teams. Next is the last question is, how to use agile KPI metrics. So there are so many agile metrics that we have. For example, like we have how to KPI is nothing but key performance indicators, right? How our entire team is doing. Like you have to like know what you're doing. All the user stories needs to be under your control. Every acceptance criteria that you write, you need to be well aware of what is happening. So you can always use certain metrics. That's why we have reports, sprint burn down chart, or you can have release burn down chart, epic burn down charts, and velocity tracking. And then you have control chart. And you have cumulative flow diagram, and we have even more metrics also. When you have defects, how to raise a defect, how to fix a defect, how to track a defect. So all this task tracker, defect tracker, all this you can make use of these charts, and then you can use these metrics to make sure that you are following Agile properly. Okay, Agile means there are so many terminologies involved in these Agile projects, so this will take some time for you to learn every single like terminology. Will be new to you if you're a beginner. So learn all these things one by one and apply. Get the access to Jira software, and you need to try it by yourself and understand each of these charts. And you have to like understand simply by song. I'm telling you again and again, simply by seeing these videos, you cannot be an expert. In order to become an expert, you have to download this software, you have to try all these charts one by one by yourself, and then you have to get an experience out of this. Only then you'll be like understanding what are these agile KPI metrics, how to use this every chart, reports, and trackers. Okay, so I hope this video was helpful. Thank you for watching.